Let's continue our study of module 4, chapter 15, classes and objects. In yesterday's class, we studied how to create an object and how to assign attributes to the values. And we also created an object point, and we assigned the attributes x and y to the object. So today let's see how to create rectangles. So we want to define a class rectangle to represent the rectangle in a space. To represent the rectangle in a space, we have to specify the size of the rectangle and also where the rectangle lies in the space. So for performing that, we use one corner of a rectangle, that is, we represent one corner of a rectangle, width and height of the rectangle. So this is how the class definition should look like. So class rectangle, and here we have to mention it represents a rectangle, and the attributes of this are width, height and corner. Now we have to instantiate a rectangle object. So here we are instantiating a rectangle object. So how do we do that? We write box is equal to rectangle and parenthesis. With this, we have created a rectangle. Now, we have created a rectangle. We have to assign the values for the attributes. So, box.width is 100, height is 200, and we have to represent the corner, that is a point where the rectangle lies in the space. So, we can make use of the point class which we had already defined in the previous class. So box dot corner is equal to point. So one of the attributes of the box instance is again an object. Now that point is a class, we have to assign the values for the attributes of point. So we can do that by writing box dot corner dot x. You can observe box dot corner dot x is 0, box dot corner dot y is equal to 0. That means we are trying to represent the rectangle of width 100, height 200 and from the origin. So how do we read this statement? The expression box dot corner dot x means go to the object box, refers to and select the attribute named corner. Now, you have selected the attribute corner of the box. Then, go to the object. The object corner. Then, select the attribute named x. That is, we are referring to the object box. And within that, the attribute is corner. Since corner itself is an object again, we have to refer to the attribute of corner. So, that is what it means. Now, instances can be returned as values from the functions. So, functions can return instances. So, here we have an example. So, function findCenter, we are writing findCenter function, takes rectangle as an argument and returns a point that contains the coordinates of the center of the rectangle. So, here we have written a function. We have defined a function findCenter that takes one rectangle as an object, as an argument to it. Now, p is equal to some point. So, this p is an object which we are creating within the function findCenter. Now, p has the attributes x and y. So, we have to assign the values for x and y. And this point p will be representing the center of the rectangle. So, here we have the formula to calculate the center of the rectangle. That is, first it divides the width by 2, then adds the corner x to it and assigns it to p dot x. Then p dot y is rectangle dot height slash 2. That is, first the division is done, then this addition. Now we have both the attributes for p. Now we return p. So this is an example to show that the function can return the objects. Now, this function will not execute on its own. So, it has to be invoked. So, to invoke that, here we have a statement. That is, center is equal to find center box. Box we have already defined with the attributes. 100 for the width, 200 for the height, and the corner is 00. So, we have already created that box. That box we are passing as an argument to the find center function. Now, this values of this box will be carried to the rectangle. So, whatever changes we make in the rectangle will also be assigned to box, because when we pass it as an argument, we are actually passing a reference to it. Now, this returns P, and the P is copied in the variable center, the object center, and we print point center. We have already written print point function. You have to refer to that. So, the print point function will print the values that are there in the center. So, this example shows that function can return objects. Now, the objects are mutable, meaning you can change the values of the objects, that is the attributes of, you can change the attributes of the object. So, the state of the object may be changed by making an assignment to one of its attributes, at least to one of its attributes. So, to change the size of the rectangle without changing its position. Now, I want to increase the size of the rectangle. So, what we do is, we do box.width is equal to box.width plus 50. That is, I'm increasing the width by 50 and I'm increasing the height by 100. I'm not changing the origin of it. That is, I'm not changing the corner. So, we can also write functions to modify the objects. So, here is a function which modifies the object which we have already created. So, with the example here, width was 100, now it's become 150. Height was 100, it's become 200. Now, we have a grow rectangle function which takes three arguments. First one is an object and the next two are just the values. And we can change the values or the width of the rectangle and the height of the rectangle by writing these statements. That is, we are incrementing the width by d width. We are incrementing the height by d height. Now, if you try to print the values, it shows box dot width was 150 and box dot width height is 300. So, if you invoke the rectangle, that is grow rectangle function once again with bypassing 50 and 100, so these are the values 200 and 400. That is, we can invoke the function any number of times. Now, we should remember that inside a function, rectangle is an alias for box. That is, it's another name given to the box. It's the same object which we are referring. So, when the function modifies a rectangle, box also changes. Now, with this, what happens is, you may be making changes for the box object in multiple functions. But, that is not what is desired. We want to make changes only in some functions, and those changes should not be reflected in the calling function. So, in such cases, we can use a copy operation. So, copy an object is often an alternative to aliasing. Copy module contains a function called copy that can duplicate any object. That is, we have a module called copy, and that copy module in turn has a copy function that will duplicate any object. You can see that here. So, point P1 is a point with these values. Now, I say import copy. So, whenever we are using a new module, we have to import it. So, we write import copy, then P2 is equal to copy dot copy P1. So, this is the module copy, this is the function copy, and this is the object P1. Now, P1 and P2 contain the same data, but they're not the same point object. That is, they're two different objects. Those they have the same values within them. They are two different objects. For example, if x and y are variables, x is equal to 10, y is equal to 10. So, both have the same values 10, but they're two different variables. So, it's something like that. So when you say P2 is equal to copy dot copy P1, P2 is created, a new object, and the values of P1 are copied into that. But remember, there are two different objects. So now we can check that. So print point P1, it will print 3, 4. Print point P2 will also print 3, 4. But is P1 P2? That is, if you write a statement P1 is P2, it shows false. Because is an operator which will compare the values of both the operands, and also it will compare the type of it. Now is not an operator defined for the user defined data types. Now P1 and P2 are objects. They are objects of what type? Point type. And point is a user defined data type. So for that user defined data type, is operator is not defined. So it shows false. Is operator compares the data type as well as the values. If the data types are same and if the values are also same, I mean if they are referring to the same memory location only, then it says true. Otherwise it says false. Is operator is not defined for the user defined data types. In case we want, we have to define it. That's why it shows false. The use of copy.copy to duplicate a rectangle, we'll find that it copies the rectangle object but not the embedded point. You can check that here. So I have a box object. I've written box2 is equal to copy.copy box. Now, is box2 the same as box? No. It's not. We have seen in the previous example also. But box2.corner is box corner, it is true. This is because this is how the copy function will do it. You can observe this is box. So width is 100, height is 200, and the corner itself is an object, and that object is referring to the values x and y here. Now when you make box2 is equal to copy dot copy box, this is what happens. A new box2 gets created, and the width and the height are copied and they refer to a different memory location, but corner object will be referring to the same object as we did it earlier. So the copy function will not create a different location for the embedded objects. That is the reason it's showing is box2.corner is the same as box.corner, it is true. So this type of operation is called a shallow copy, because it copies the object and any references it contains but not the embedded objects. Then how do we create totally two different objects? So for that we have a method called deep copy within the copy module. So box3 is equal to copy dot deep copy box. Then box3 is box false, because they are two different objects. Box3.corner is box.corner. This is also false now. So now box3 and box are completely separate objects. So when we are executing this, there may be some exceptions. Let's see these exceptions, some of the exceptions. So if you try to access an attribute that does not exist, you get an attribute error. We get an attribute error. Now P is equal to point, an object. P dot x is 3, P dot y is 4. We try to access P dot z is equal to 5. The z attribute does not exist. So it shows the attribute error. Now we want to check whether we have an instance of that particular class. So you can use isInstance function to check whether the object is an instance of a particular class or not. So here is an example, isInstance p, point. With this you are trying to find whether p is an instance of the class point. right now we have created is instance, we have already created the point object P, so it shows true. If you write is instance Q comma point, we have not created Q, so it will show false. Then there are several times where we want to find whether a particular object has an instance, has an attribute or not. So for that we have the has attribute function. So here we have an example. So has attribute P comma X as a string. So this will say true if X is an attribute of the point object. So since we have X, it shows true. Now I am checking whether Z is an attribute of P, it shows false. In this, the first argument should be an object and the second argument should be a string that contains the name of the attribute. So this should be written as a string. Now we can also use a try statement to see if the object has the attribute we need or not. So we can perform the same operation in try. Okay, X is equal to PX, then accept attribute error. So what happens here is, if you have the attribute X in the object P, we can make this assignment. If X does not exist, then the control goes to the accept block where it shows the attribute error. Since we have the value X defined, now it shows X is equal to 0. So these are some of the error debugging concepts we have in Python. Of course, this is not what we have in Python. This is not only what we have in Python. There's a lot in Python, but practice these first so that you get an idea about how these work, how the attributes and how the copy, how the values and all work, how the methods and how the modules and all work. You can explore more on that. So keep studying. Thank you.